rękodzieło dla wnętrz, architektura, a z drugiej strony cieplutki świat mięciutkich kocyków, dzierganych włóczek i rękodzieła w ogóle. Dlaczego o tym mówię? Bo w tym moim online MBA-u, o którym wspominałam Ci też w innym odcinku, więc odsyłam Cię do informacji na temat tego właśnie online MBA-a, czyli Sigrun's Online MBA Somba, poznałam koleżankę, która uświadomiła mi, że rzadko mówię o architekturze, pomimo że jestem z zawodu architektem. Tak, to moje zaplecze i wieloletnie doświadczenie sprawiło, że jest to taka rzecz, o której w ogóle nie wspominam, bo wydaje mi się taka oczywista. To właśnie Michelle Petit uświadomiła mi, że mamy bardzo podobne podejście do urządzania wnętrz. Już Ci mówię, o co mi chodzi. Bardzo często mamy taki stereotyp w głowie, że ktoś, kto zatrudnia architekta, no to już albo osoba, która ma bardzo duży budżet, albo w ogóle osoba, która ma Bóg wie jakie wymagania, albo osoba, która po prostu nie potrafi urządzać wnętrz, więc zatrudnia kogoś, żeby to zrobił. No teraz jeszcze wchodzi element czasu, po prostu nie mam na to czasu i dlatego kogoś zatrudniam. Ale mało kto z nas zastanawia się nad tym, jak te wnętrza urządzać. Dlaczego do niektórych domów wchodzimy i czujemy się jak w domu, jak w swoim domu, a do niektórych wchodzimy i czujemy się trochę obco, czujemy, że to nie nasz klimat, nie nasza bajka, albo po prostu nie jest tam przytulnie. Boimy się usiąść, przycupniemy czasami na jakimś rogu kanapy, bo boimy się, że coś dotkniemy, strącimy albo popalcujemy. I coś w tym jest, że są osoby, które potrafią tak urządzić wnętrze, żeby czuć się tam jak w domu, żeby dawało to właśnie takie poczucie przytulności. A są też osoby, które pracują w zupełnie innych stylach i tworzą wnętrza na wysoki połysk, taki glamour, który wręcz ma nas onieśmielać. A no właśnie z Michelle jesteśmy w tym obozie pod tytułem dom, przytulność. Nasze wnętrza mają emanować ciepłem, mają przyciągać, jak ta kuchnia, w której wszyscy siedzimy, żeby podyskutować wieczorem, kiedy wpadają goście i nie możemy oderwać się od dyskusji, kończymy o drugiej w nocy i rano wszyscy jesteśmy nieprzytomni. Takie właśnie są nasze wnętrza. Moje cieplutkie i mięciutkie ze względu na rękodzieło i moją wielką słabość do tych artefaktów, które właśnie dają taką strukturę i, jak to mój mąż mówi, zbierają kurz. Ale też Michelle, która wyznaje zasadę, że piękne, luksusowe, ale też przytulne wnętrza wcale nie muszą kosztować majątku. Równie dobrze porusza się w pięknych, antycznych, wartych krocie meblach, co w galaksach z Ikei, które zobaczycie za moimi plecami, celowo jako symbol przystępności, łatwości, ale też takiej elastyczności w urządzaniu i dostosowaniu do każdej indywidualnej potrzeby naszych klientów. Dlaczego o tym mówię? Bo Michelle poznałam właśnie podczas jednego z mastermindów. Jeżeli nie wiesz, co to mastermind, to też odsyłam Cię do poprzedniego wideo, gdzie mówię w ogóle o tej idei, ale pokrótce jest to idea wymiany myśli, dyskusji. Potencjalny konkurent, czyli też architekt wnętrz, Michelle, z którą teoretycznie, gdybym tak podchodziła do biznesu, nie powinnam gadać, bo przecież może mi skradnie jakiś cenny know-how, okazała się świetną partnerką do dyskusji, jak jeszcze lepiej służyć naszym klientom. Odkryłyśmy, że ten mit architekta powoli zaczyna przechodzić do lamusa. Już nie boimy się zapytać architekta o zdanie. Coraz częściej mamy też świadomość, że architekci świadczą usługi doradcze i często pomagają nam po prostu w formie jednej, drugiej konsultacji porozmawiać o wnętrzach, doradzić kilka rzeczy i niekoniecznie kasować ciężkie tysiące za to, że zrobią cokolwiek za nas. Często uczą nas po prostu, jak mamy to zrobić samodzielnie, żeby po prostu oszczędzić. Dzięki Michelle zrozumiałam, że to nasze rękodzieło dla wnętrz, czyli oplotkowe warsztaty rękodzieła, służą też jako takie narzędzie do urządzania wnętrz dookoła. Nigdy nie patrzyłam na uczenie, jak zrobić fajną pufkę, dywan szydełkowy, czy nie wiem, ciekawy wełniany pled, który normalnie kosztowałby parę tysięcy, a my możemy go zrobić w cenie samej włóczki. Nigdy nie traktowałam tego jako praktycznego narzędzia urządzania własnych wnętrz. To ona pozwoliła mi to zrozumieć i to bardzo, bardzo wcześnie, na etapie takiego rodzenia się tej marki Oplotki. Będę jej za to dozgonnie wdzięczna. Ale co z tego dla Ciebie? Ano idea mastermindu. Zauważ, że potencjalnie Michelle mogłaby być moją konkurentką, którą teoretycznie nie powinnam gadać, bo jeszcze podkradnie jakiś pomysł. Ale okazało się, że ze wspólnej dyskusji i dla niej, i dla mnie popłynęły niesamowite korzyści, ponieważ ona też teraz ze mną dyskutuje, w jaki sposób te handmade'owe rzeczy może użyć, czy nauczyć swoich klientów, by używać, żeby znowu obniżać koszty całościowego projektu wnętrza. Dlaczego o tym mówię? Bo zachęcam Cię do idei mastermindu. Mastermindu, niezależnie czy z osobami z Twojej branży, czy spoza branży, tu Ci odsyłam do poprzednich filmików, żeby pokazać Ci, jak wielka wartość płynie ze wspólnej rozmowy. I to oczywiście nie tylko dlatego, że takie nieoficjalne mastermindy dzieją się podczas naszych warsztatów oplotkowych, często takich też zamawianych warsztatów, gdzie po prostu kilka osób chce ze sobą usiąść i my jesteśmy tymi, które zabawiają fajnym rękodziełem, ale zachęcam Cię do idei mastermindu w ogóle. Mamy początek roku, to jest fajny moment, żeby dołączyć do jakiejś grupy, której świadomie będziesz dyskutować na temat swojego biznesu i pracować nad swoim biznesem, a nie tylko w swoim biznesie, zaciskając pasa i ciężko, ciężko pracując. A czasami wystarczy jeden, drugi, trzeci pomysł i danie sobie takiej przestrzeni na generowanie takich fajnych pomysłów po to, żeby swoją działalność ulepszać. Dlatego ja Cię bardzo zachęcam do tego, żeby zobaczyć rozmowę z Michelle. Nagrałyśmy ją w formie podcastu już jakiś czas temu, ale zachęcam Cię do tego, żeby zobaczyć tą rozmowę i zobaczyć, jak dwie osoby, które potencjalnie mogłyby być konkurencją, mogą ze sobą współpracować i mogą nawzajem czerpać ze swoich historii. Jak się domyślasz, historia każdej z nas jest zupełnie inna i choć kręte ścieżki zawiodły nas do architektury i tu mogłybyśmy ze sobą być konkurencją, okazało się, że to splatanie naszych ścieżek daje nam zupełnie inną wartość i tym bardziej dla każdej z nas pokazuje, jak bardzo jesteśmy inne i w jak inny sposób służymy naszym klientom, przez co właśnie tą konkurencją nie jesteśmy. Możemy za to świetnie współpracować. Odsyłam Cię do tej rozmowy i życzę miłego oglądania. Do zobaczenia. Dziś nie lada gratka. Świadomie robię wstęp do tego podcastu, chociaż rzadko kiedy takie wstępy słyszycie, ponieważ dzisiejszy odcinek będzie po angielsku. Miałam niesamowitą przyjemność rozmawiać z koleżanką z programu Online MBA Somba, z Michelle. Michelle jest żywym dowodem na to, że to, co się robi, jeżeli robi się to z pasją, z takim sercem, z takim czystym powołaniem, że to jest właśnie to, co chce robić, to robi się to na najwyższym poziomie, pomimo że jest się początkującym w tak zwanym online biznesie. Ale dzisiaj nie będzie mocno biznesowo. Dzisiaj będzie bardziej o takich przełomach życiowych, o tym dochodzeniu do tego, co tak naprawdę chcemy w życiu robić. I bardzo serdecznie zapraszam Was na prześledzenie drogi Michelle. Ta informacja, którą się z nami podzieliła, budzi wiele refleksji. Jest mi bardzo bliska, bo sama podzielam tą ścieżkę projektanta wnętrz i wiele rzeczy, o których mówiła Michelle, jest mi bardzo bliska z punktu widzenia zawodowego. Ale wierzę, że w tej historii odnajdziecie bardzo cenną prawdę także dla siebie. Także zapraszam Was na oryginał rozmowy. Będzie po angielsku, będzie trochę inaczej niż zazwyczaj. Ale myślę, że ta wartość jest bezcenna, kiedy słyszycie ją w oryginale. Stwierdziłam, że tłumaczenie tej rozmowy ujęłoby jej autentyczności bardzo wiele. Także do usłyszenia i zapraszam Was na rozmowę z Michelle. Okay, so today we're starting with a new series of our episodes, Oplotki episodes, which are actually more inspirational than ever. We met live with Michelle during Sigrun Live. I was really excited, and then there was this crazy idea to invite these women into podcast interviews in order to introduce them even better to you. I really believe that the message, the work they do, is so inspirational that even if it seems to be a bit far away from our handmade world, it might give you a lot of insights. So without further ado, I really want to introduce you Michelle, who is doing crazy thing, but I'm not telling that. That's Michelle's job.
Hello. I'm Michelle, and thank you, Agnieszka, for having me on the podcast. It's really exciting, I have to say. So my name is Michelle, and I'm originally from Switzerland. I'm living in Zurich. My heritage comes a little bit, I'm a little bit a mix of English, Italian, French, so I'm kind of European, as I worked also for a big Swedish company, and that's me, and I'm turning homes into castles. So with, in other words, I help you to make your home cozy welcoming, so that you can feel at home, because I've learned in the past 12 years or even more that you can't buy any feeling by just having nice furniture in your home. You have to have them placed in the right way. And there are some small things sometimes just to change so that you can really feel home and can relax. That's what I do. So, and as we met in Zurich, I was immediately, you know, inspired by your work. And I thought, you know, let's share our knowledge and share our inspiration together. So it's really exciting to be here.
It's so great that we actually share a common background with this interior design. And I'm really happy because you're like in the middle of that. And I'm kind of, you know, yes, doing other things now. And it's so precious because you've got this wonderful idea that it doesn't matter what budget you're in or what budget do you have to invest into your place. You can always make it a cozy place that you feel at home at. And I just really am looking forward to talk to you about that.
Yeah, actually, sometimes, you know, as I said before, we always think that we have to have an interior designer, which is good in certain ways, but sometimes we just can't afford it. And then just to get some ideas to replace stuff or just to redo things, then it's much easier to you know, do it by yourself, and do not hesitate to do it. That's what keeps us away, because I also have the impression that I really, really love and I appreciate Pinterest. I really do. And I think it's a wonderful platform to get inspiration. But on the other hand, it also puts a lot of pressure on us, because it, you know, it shows how it should be. But sometimes it's not like this. And I really, my goal is to make each home unique, as we are as humans, and that everyone feels really home and relaxed. And that's also, you know, that if you have people coming over, that they don't feel like it's like a showroom. It is a home where you have to live and where you can be as you are. And that's actually my goal.
It's so precious what you're saying about, you know, Pinterest inspiration. I'm a total Pinterest addict myself, mm-hmm, not only like business-wise, but also like a private-wise. And it really shows that even once we have kids, it starts to be unrealistic to have those places, you know, mm-hmm, so perfectly set and so cozy, because then the reality changes. And what you said, that each of our homes is totally unique, because that's kind of impression or prolongation of ourselves, and we are totally unique. That's really precious what you say. Is there a method to what you do, how you do that, and how you work? Do you have like structure? Because I know that you kind of feel it, like you know what to do. But do you have it like structured in a way?
I just did a live video yesterday where I showed up, where I talked about how can you find out if something is placed in the right way. And what I experience is always that if you place anything, I mean, when we take decoration, for example, if you place something like a picture or, I don't know, a small Buddha statue, whatever, you know, comes in your mind or what you like, and you place it somewhere, and actually, when you just step back like a half a meter and you watch it and you look at it and you just go like, okay, is this right or wrong, or is this feeling good or not? You immediately have this sense. We all have it, but we just don't use it. And yeah, it's like in the morning when you wear clothes, you immediately know if you feel good or not. And that's actually also with interior. You immediately know, oh no, that doesn't feel right. Even though if it's not right, just take it away. And also another topic which I think is really important when it comes to interior is that we should, from a color perspective, is trying to go really general in like when you take a sofa, or if you are having the intention to buy something, go just try to be as general in color colors or as natural in colors as you can go. Because if you have a normal sofa and you place it, or you buy a red one, which probably looks good, but after a certain time you can't, you know, you can't look at it anymore. Yeah. So if you take something in natural colors, this gives space for going crazy in decoration. And decoration is fun, decoration is inspiring, and decoration is changed quickly. So this is always my biggest advice to people who are moving in or are having the attention to change something. If it's the bigger the investment, the general the color should be. And everything which is in a natural color gives us, as I said before, space for going crazy with decoration.
Yeah, no, we still have like this season of crazy Christmas decoration coming up. So that's the best advice you could give. Like, don't go crazy with all the basic things. Go crazy with the decoration.
Yes, you can do that. And it's, you know, after Christmas, you take it away and then probably there is a calm season coming up until Easter, or even though there's probably Valentine's, whatever you want to go for. But, you know, if you have, I think it blocks you in a certain way when you have a pink sofa and a blue bed and some green curtains. It just doesn't give you space for anything else. So you have to stick to these colors. And if you go general, like, you know, everything which is in wooden colors, brown, ebony, whatever, just natural colors. And also gray is also a great color to start with. And then add on like pink candles or red candles for Christmas, whatever you like. But then that's actually one of my biggest advices as well. Exactly. But there will be some other stuff which we could talk about hours for, so
I will link that down to how to find you online, because I'm like taking a look what you're saying in your lives or like on your landing pages, and those are, you know, things that we think are really simple, but before somebody shows us how to do that, it's really hard. It's actually looking so easy when you tell that. That's your secret, that's your genius, that you make it so fun, that you make it so light, and then we get this craving for, you know, changing our, you know, house environment, because it's not that, you know, hard thing to do and such a labor to, you know, make it possible. But was it always that way? Was it that you always knew that you're going to do something with interior design? Or was it like a longer journey that took you to this place that you're doing that? Because obviously it shows that you're a zone of genius.
Thank you. You know, I did some exercise during also my time at Somba now. And I realized, when I look back, I started already as a small girl to draw, you know, planification for my own room. And I still have it. So in my cellar, I was looking for it. So I still have these drawings. Probably I will have to put them on my website someday, one day. But I still have them. And it always was important to me to have, you know, like a cozy home. It didn't actually matter what it was, but I had to feel really cozy. And I it was a journey. And I mean, I wanted to be an interior designer when I was 16, but the world told me, you can't be that. So I went into electricity, where light projects were one of my goals. I did, and I experienced this for 4 years I was in this job. So, and then I changed completely. I went into tourism, and completely different stories. But then some kind of a little announcement in the newspaper showed up that there was a Swedish company looking for a project manager. And I was like, what is that? And when I started there, it was really based on office furniture. And I was like, oh no, that's just not me. You know, it's just not. Office furniture is really, you know, like, but I have to say, it's just one part of the whole puzzle. So if you start with office, you can see how this changed so quickly, and how much it, or how important it is also that you have a nice office when you are in the corporate world, that you have the right settings there. And the first time I went to Sweden, I had to be there for education more than a week, and it completely, you know, took me in, and I couldn't stop it anymore. And there, actually, a small fire was on in my inside of me, where I knew, okay, this is absolutely where I want to go, and this is more or less 12 years ago. And yeah, and that's how everything started. And I just, you know, it's a process, and I became more and more aware of it, that in my business world, this is one thing, but also that friends came over to me and said, hey, could you help me? I have a problem here. I have a friend of mine, she owns a house, and her upper level was just a disaster. And after her separation, I said, you know, you should do an Airbnb. And she said, but you know, I don't have the money. I don't know how to do this. And I said, okay, let's grab everything we have and then let's start. And it's just a wonderful place where she can rent it out now. And it looks really fantastic. And she didn't, you know, we didn't add it an interior designer. We didn't hundreds of euros. It was like small stuff we add, like cushions, a small candle there, a small light there, a nice little carpet. And that was it. And she's renting it out. She earns money with it. And it's perfect. So there is my passion. And I think that's what I'm really, really love about doing this.
It's so great that you share that, you know, you don't need some expensive furniture, because actually that makes things easier, right? If you've got like a huge budget and you can, you know, even hire an interior designer, that's the easy part. But it's actually really hard to use what you already have, because there are some, you know, difficulties, blockages, maybe mismatched colors or things like that. But still you can make this, you know, magnificent feeling when it's all over, that it really works, that it's doable.
Absolutely.
Is it that you kind of discovered that, or was it just kind of a process, or just as you said, that people told you that you're good at it? How it happened that you knew that, okay, that's a skill, that's something that actually people need from me?
I can give you an example. I was in the Swiss mountains a couple of weeks ago. I was invited from a couple friend, and they bought an apartment from his father, and it was really, you know, it looks nice, but it was still, you know, I mean, the furniture were new, and also the decoration was just like really, really old. And then while they were cooking and preparing some stuff, I asked them, hey, would you mind that I just go through the rooms and move some stuff and put something on a different area or different place? And she was like, yeah, just go. And I just moved like three chairs. I moved one lamp and some other little stuff. And she came into the room and she was like, wow. And I said, you know, that's it. You don't have to have an interior designer, even though they are doing great jobs, but you don't have to have also a certain amount of money to invest for having a nice home. And there I really feel that it's really the right placement, which is important. My mantra is keep it simple. And that's probably one thing which helps to also in an interior way. You don't have to have Vitra and all these fancy stuff. You can have it, of course. And I can work with this as well. My life partner has a really nice apartment, really fancy furnitures. And he put, you know, when he moved in, I looked at it and I said, it looks really nice, but it's not cozy. And it's not welcoming, and it doesn't invite you. If an area or a room doesn't invite you to go in and sit there, there's something wrong. And we all know that. It's also kind of a feng shui perspective. You know, there are rooms where you sit down and feel comfortable, and there are rooms where you just go like, okay, it's nice to see it, but you don't feel invited. And you can also see that if you are at home, there are some spots where you really sit down and really stay. And there are some areas where you just use. And I can also say that it's you can see that when there is the dining table, there is actually a structure how it should be, how a family should sit down on the table so that everyone is in the right spot. And when you change these things and when you know these things, how to place a person, immediately they feel comfortable and the kids will stay at the table. And it's the same with everything, with placing a bed, placing a table where you have to work, or if you want to get just, you know, disturbed all the time, you just have, or when you get disturbed all the time, you have to move stuff. And it's all about feeling good. That's the most important thing. And
it's feeling so well. Important what you say, that the setting kind of determines how we feel. And if we've got like a nice setting for our work, it's like a pleasure to sit down and do some stuff that we have to do. We don't get this much distracted. One thing that I remember, that it's nice to have a wall behind your back to feel secure. That's what I'm cultivating as well. And, you know, I already had one question I shared with my friend that we're going to have an interview. And she was, wow, so fun that you finally have somebody with, you know, your background, like with interior design. I kind of, you know, forgot about this world, and it's so passionate, and I'm so happy that you're here. And she said, yeah, you have to ask her, how does she do that she can do it online? Because, you know, we've got this stereotype in our mind that if somebody enters our home, like, you know, proper interior designer and, you know, does all the measurings and, you know, could see the place, then he or she can do the work. But she was like, but how she's doing that online? How is that even possible? So that's the question. I know that it is, but I needed to ask this question.
I was asking myself the same question. How can I bring this offline business into online? And actually, I just dived into it and I just tried it out. And what worked the best was, and I have an online going course now, just it's now taking place. And I asked the ladies or the people to give me like three perspectives or three pictures from different angles. And this works quite well. What helps me the most is when you have a video, you know, or a panorama picture where I really can see everything. And I had a 5-day challenge ongoing, and I had one lady. She showed, and I, you know, I gave them the possibility to put some pictures in the group, and what they did. And then I was looking at this picture, and I was like going, okay, this is gonna be my first big online challenge. I don't know what to do. But suddenly, you know, I was asking some questions, how they would like to have it, when they use it the most, what is important to them. And so I, you know, it's a process where I can really, if I talk to them and they, you know, give me the answers, I can feel how they like it. And then I just gave them a few advices. And you can't imagine the change. I will post this in my Facebook site, so you can see the difference. It's just tremendous. It's absolutely stunning what they've done. And yeah, it's in the online business, I never thought it's going to work out. But what we do also is that we have an inventory list, so that you start to write down what you have. I mean, literally everything. And then you see how rich you really are. And then we can say, okay, you have this and that. And this is the most important thing which we want to move and what we have to change. And then, you know, we are sometimes we are also stuck that this cupboard has to stay in this room because we bought it for this room, but probably not. So it's also to be open for change and to place some stuff or use stuff in a different way. And that's how I do it online. And I'm actually only in the beginning, but I can see that this works quite well. Probably there is also another way of doing it, but at the moment, this is how I do it, and it works really good.
For me, it's totally life-changing because, you know, we tend to push those important decisions about doing something in our house for later time because we kind of feel that it's such a burden, it's such a hard work, and there's so much to do to make it really, you know, work. And you're like living proof that you can actually, you know, take a short program, do some simple steps, and wow, voila, it's ready. And you don't have to, you know, postpone it after Christmas or spring break or, you know, your holidays or something. You just need to do it, and that's so precious. Mm-hmm. I also had to ask you one question because I know that you're a knitter, so you're kind of, you have this handmade, you know, point in you. Does it somehow connect to your work? Do you kind of, because some people, you know, they use handmade just to relax. For us, it's kind of work and relax, like work slash relax. But I'm really curious, how do you use this knitting passion of yours?
I knew it I learned it in school and then I forgot about it. And then my sister moved out from Switzerland and she was, or she still is, really into knitting. And she was doing these things really quickly in such, you know, such a nice way. And she bought, I don't know how much wool, which was useful or which was here to use. And I sat here and I was like, okay, what shall I do? And then actually I was looking for a certain color for a small cover for my sofa, which was not, I didn't found it, neither online, neither in shops. And then I said to myself, you know what, I'm just going to start knitting again. And that's what I did. And it's a simple thing. It's nothing really, you know, big and huge, but it makes me feel really, you know, calm down. And it gives me inspiration to think about what's the next step in my business and what could I do. And in the evenings, it's the time for a restart again, because now the winter time is back again and I just love it. You know, sometimes I've just kept on knitting and kept on having my notebook beside and, you know, had all these inspirational thoughts and I wrote them down and then there were like two lines of knitting and going back to my notebook. So for me, it's really, you know, relaxing, also doing sport instead.
It's so great that you're telling that, because I actually found a study that proves that once we incorporate our, you know, manual skills, like doing things manually, just like knitting, it kind of activates places in our brain that we don't normally use. And what you said, that the best ideas come to your mind while you're knitting, while you're relaxed and doing something with your hands, is actually already proven. I'm so happy that we talked about it, because we as handmade people, we don't kind of, you know, perceive it as a gift that we are so privileged to do the work manually. And this way our brain kind of works, you know, in different directions. And what you said, it really happens. I also, when I have like a difficulty in my business, I just sit down and knit, and my husband is always, you know, yeah, you've got something wrong happening, or and he knows that the big knitted, you know, blanket's gonna appear suddenly. But it's really, really precious that we talked about it. That's also a method, right? It gives you pleasure and it gives you fun, but it also gives you some insights that you wouldn't have, like sitting by your desk by computer all the time.
It's a kind of meditation. It's meditative.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm really happy that you also talked about this idea that handmade could fill out this void where we don't have ready-made products. Mm-hmm. And handmade allows us to, you know, accommodate them to our needs. Just as you said, pick up the right color or the right size, because you cannot find it online or offline. And that's a great opportunity for, you know, handmade professionals to actually cooperate with interior designers. I know that this idea was, you know, for quite a while in Oplotki, but actually that's another proof that it's worth investigating and worth digging deeper.
Absolutely.
Michelle, I don't want to, you know, take you any longer, but I have like this one big question that I always like promise myself to ask our guest on the podcast, because we've got this tendency that we like overestimate our successes. And we kind of, you know, look up to them. That's obvious. We are happy about our successes. But I I also have this feeling that those moments when it's hard, or when we think, no, it's not the right way, or we have those kind of moments that we feel we are kind of low, or something wrong happened, or something unexpected happened. Those are actually those moments that change things into to make us who we are, or put us in a place where we actually want to be. Do you also have something about your professional life that kind of, you know, did that massive shift that gave you this kind of feedback that, that actually you feel that that was a strong lesson and now you're at this point where you are?
Yeah. I have this experience, as we probably all have. As I said before, I was employed for a Swedish company, and I thought, this is it, you know, this is really the way I want to go. And that's, you know, having this kind of safety, good paid job, but still being creative and still being, myself. And I thought, you know, and I also told to everyone, now this is it. I will be, you know, until the end of my work career, I'm going to be here. And I really thought it was. And then life taught me something else. It was completely, or it went completely crazy. And I had the work was just overloaded. And I started with 4 employees and I ended up with 14. Wow. And it was just crazy, the workload and the pressure I had on my shoulders. And then suddenly I had a hearing loss for over 6 months. And there I realized, if you don't do what you really love, even though I didn't knew what I'm gonna do, I just knew that it can't be, you know, it's not just the way I should be, or it should be. And then it really hit me hard. I really had a serious, you know, serious issues with letting go of this idea, being an MD and having this certain, you know, level of work. And then I realized, if I don't do what I really love, and I can feel that I'm really doing it now, then you should not do it for long. I mean, you can do sometimes we have to do certain jobs, or we have to do certain things to get us from one level to another, but still, you know, the positivity has to be more present than anything else. And there I realized in this time of my life that just being in a job or doing things which you don't really feel good, really, really means like you don't hesitate in the morning to get up. And that's what I feel at the moment since I decided to do this. It's I can go to bed at 2 and I can get up at 7 without any problems. And I think it's this, in how you say that, it's this motivation which comes from the inside. Absolutely. Yeah. Instead of being this rabbit running behind this carrot, you know, and I think that was actually one of my biggest life-changing things I had, realizing I'm not doing this job, or I'm doing a job which I'm not supposed to. And now I would say nothing can hold me back. I just go for it. And I don't actually care what some people think of me. I just do whatever I think is right. And I can see that I attract the people around me, that they give me they just confirm that is the right thing. And what I can say, or what I could tell to anybody who is listening, is like, if you get up in the morning and you're frustrated in one or another way, stop it. It's not worth it. It's just not worth it, because we have this life and we should get the best and the most out of it. And if you don't do what you love, change.
Yeah, that's so precious what you said. We tend to forget that the most important voice we should, listen is right inside of us. Like, we don't have to look very far. Mm. We just have it like underneath our heart or somewhere. Absolutely. In the middle.
Right? And, if you listen to your heart, what I always said to my kids is, do what your heart tells you, because your heart has beaten before any thought became or came into your mind. So, and I think that's the most important. And we all know what we want. We all know what we really like and love, but sometimes we just, you know, our priorities are on a different level. So
exactly. Yeah. There's only last one thing that I really, really needed to mention, because it's like, it's so important what you said, that this breakthrough comes from your inside. It's just as simple as listening to your inner voice. And sometimes we hear that voice, we already know what we want, but we are a bit afraid of, you know, taking a step, taking the action. And I was at the same place as you're telling, that in a way I kind of felt that I'm supposed to do different things in life, but I kind of went into this rabbit hole because, you know, money, safety, kids and the family. And then there's this moment, we actually had a similar moment when joining Somba, and it was like, you know, it's a simple thing. That's like an, you know, online MBA. That's a program. That's a tool that helps us to, you know, grow and have the right tool set to follow what we are doing. But I kind of feel that it wasn't for that program, we wouldn't have met. And it's sometimes that you're, you know, afraid of maybe investing in yourself. Maybe you're some kind of on the verge of doing that, but you don't have a person that would kind of slightly push you into doing things that you already feel that you are supposed to be doing. Was it the same story with you? Was it like that you, I don't know, discovered Somba somehow, or was it, you know, perfect time that you kind of saw the opportunity, or how did that journey go? I'm really, really curious. Was it, you know, by accident, by chance, or?
I don't know if there are accidents or chances. I think it's a destiny somehow. And I met Sigrun, the founder of Somba, on an event in my career as an MD for this Swedish company. She came to an event which I organized years ago, 2013, I think, or 14, it was. Wow. I don't actually remember. And I followed her, you know, followed her through her career and through her steps she's taken. And I always had her on my mind. But to be honest, and really honest, I literally don't remember how the hell this masterclass showed up on my screen. And as I said, I'm still in a corporate job, and I was supposed to do some really annoying Excel sheets. And then I just opened up my private laptop and I said, okay, let's, you know, just have a break and just go through Facebook and check what's going on. And there she was. And she was talking about online business. And I always was like, oh no, this is, I don't know how this works, and all these tools and all these, you know, Zoom and videos, and I'm not into this, and I don't know how I should start. And then I you know, I just left my private computer open, and it was just ongoing, and ladies were asking some stuff, and then I was like, okay, what did she say? And then I slowly but certain I shifted from corporate world to what is this? And it was like a magnet to me, and I couldn't stop listening. And I was stuck in front of my laptop for four hours. And then she came up with this Somba, and I was like, what is this? And then I went on her website, and then I said, okay, let's get serious. I mean, first of all, I can't afford it. And then I had my lizard brain, you know, coming up, and said, you know, how should you do this? It's a corporate job. You have a corporate job, and interior business, you can't do this online. How would you do that? And then I was like, you know, between my devil and my angel sitting on my shoulders, and I was like listening to one and to the other one, and I was like, but you know, I really want to have this trip, but I don't know how. And I had a call with one or two team members from Sigrun, and I asked everything, literally everything, what I wanted to know. And they were probably overwhelmed, because I wanted to know how to get this and how to get my investment back as fast as possible. And I want to have this five-figure business go running by end of the year. And I was really eager to know everything. And then I suddenly just pressed enter, go.
Wow. So
and then I was surprised by myself. And I called my partner and I said, I just did it. And he said, what? I said, I just bought this samba. He said, what? And I said, yeah, you know, you don't know what, but just tell me it's good. And he said, oh, okay, it's good. So he didn't know what I'm talking. But anyway, I just did it. And then I started samba summer school. And it was just, wow, it was overwhelming, but it was so good. And I didn't, you know, probably it was good. I didn't know what I was doing.
Yeah, it's like that you trusted your own guts and your feeling, and you kind of felt that you need a change, and that's the change coming up. Like,
And it, you know, it just sucked me in. It just took me, and I just followed the process. And I always said to myself, okay, Sigrun always says, trust the process. Okay, I do that. And I, you know, and I just did what she told us. Probably not everything, but most of it, I've just done it. And then I changed my first idea completely. So now I'm into what I really love, and that's perfect. I mean, I always tell people when they ask me, "Hey, Michelle, how are you?" I just tell them it's the best time in my life.
That's such a precious thing to say to anybody, right?
Yes.
That you actually feel that's the best time of your life.
Yes, it is.
I'm so grateful that you shared this story, because I also had this feeling that sometimes we just, like, we're a bit lonely in this online business, and people treat us, you know, not really seriously, because it's like, you know, fun business, and you're always, you know, smiling when you're talking about what you do, and people just like look at you and like, this crazy person, what is she talking about? And it actually works. It actually shifts us more into this edutainment, that you provide services that are really valuable and needed, but you do it in a fun way. You kind of make it fun because you love it and you're kind of in your zone of genius, and it's so important. And I'm really grateful to you that, you know, we've managed to spread that message, that no matter what you do, but if you love it, if you're really meant to do that, it will show, and you will attract clients and the right people to your business.
Absolutely.
And it's going to be fun to work. And that's the one thought that I want to leave our listeners with. Thank you, Michelle, so much for this interview. It's so precious to have you here.
Thank you, Agnieszka. It was a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Wideo, które oglądasz, to część takiego dużego wyzwania. Często otrzymuję mailowe pytania o różne zagadnienia związane z prowadzeniem biznesu w oparciu o rękodzieło lub szeroko rozumianego biznesu online, jako że sama od jakiegoś czasu już w tym siedzę. Postanowiłam rzucić sobie wyzwanie i przez 2021 będę na te pytania regularnie odpowiadać. Codziennie jedno pytanie, jedna odpowiedź. Zapraszam Cię, jeżeli Ty też masz pytanie, pisz agnieszka@oplotki.pl.